Hey everyone, welcome to our Sky Tonight program. This is Seth Mayo, curator of astronomy for the Loman Planetarium. And in this week's episode, we're covering the dates of April 12th through April 18th. And what we'll talk about at first is the celebration of International Human Spaceflight Day, or Yuri's Night. That is the anniversary of the first human flight into space on April 12th, 1961. So we'll talk a little more about that holiday. Then we're going to dive into the constellation Hydra, which is very well placed in the sky at this time of the year, talk about its mythology and a special star within it. Then we're going to shift our attention to the north, look at the Big Dipper, and talk about the constellation it resides in. So let's get to it. So April 12th of each year is officially recognized as International Human Spaceflight Day, and this is a day to remember and to celebrate the first spaceflight event with a human on board. And that was, of course, by Russia or the Soviet Union back on April 12th, 1961, with the Vostok 1 mission, and that was launching the very famous cosmonaut known as Yuri Gagarin, who made the first flight and orbit around the Earth on April 12th. And I have actually the night sky set to Baikonur, Kazakhstan, where Yuri Gagarin launched from in his Vostok 1 capsule. And this is actually the night sky set for Baikonur the evening after his launch and landing. And it's kind of neat to see sort of the same constellations we're seeing now, some of the winter and spring objects. But what's really great is that the planet Mars is in the sky just like it is now in the evening towards the west. It's in a slightly different location because Mars in our current sky here in 2021 is within the constellation Taurus the Bull that we find here. But on the evening of Gagarin's flight, you can see that Mars is situated here inside the constellation the Gemini twins, so Mars wasn't too far away. So the sky is actually pretty similar as it was then compared to now, which is pretty cool. So this is a very important date for human spaceflight history. The evening of this is usually called Yuri's Night, and since 2001, people have been celebrating this event and celebrating the achievement of sending people into space. And April 12th is also the anniversary of the first space shuttle flight that occurred on April 12th, 1981, so just 20 years to the day after Yuri Gagarin's flight. And so another anniversary to celebrate as well with Space Shuttle Columbia in its first flight. It was more of a test flight, if you want to call it that, STS-1, with just two astronauts on board. And that was Bob Crippen and John Young. And that was a very exciting mission because it was the first type of spacecraft where we launched like a rocket and you landed like a glider or airplane. So it was a first for space flight. And again, only 20 years after the first human flight. And so these anniversaries are fun to celebrate. And this is the night actually in the Kennedy Space Center, kind of Titusville area, of the first space shuttle launch. And again, same time of year because it's still April 12th with the same constellations. But for them, that night, they had a nice, fairly large moon. And you'll notice off to the east, Jupiter and Saturn were pretty close to each other as well. So we didn't really get to see Mars in the evening, but we saw those gas giants. So it's kind of fun to look at the night sky both on those nights. So back to April 12th of 2021, this year actually marks the 60th anniversary of Yuri Gagarin's flight and, of course, the 40th anniversary of the first space shuttle flight. But for now, we can celebrate International Human Spaceflight Day here on Earth for April 12th. This week is a great time to celebrate a constellation that doesn't get enough attention, and that's something called Hydra. And in the spring, Hydra you can see rising out of the east and southeast here, and it's not one of the brightest groupings of stars, but it does spread out across a huge swath of the night sky. It's actually one of the largest constellations that you can find throughout the entire star field as seen from Earth. And once you finally see it, it really does kind of look like a slithering sea snake that you see meandering through the sky. And it is kind of alone. There's not a lot of bright things around it. So if you are in a darker environment, especially kind of the beginning of this week when the moon is not too large, you may have a decent opportunity to see this. So where Hydra is right now, we're looking towards the southeast, and you can see some stars kind of meandering around like this. And a little higher up in the sky, you'll see kind of a grouping of stars that make this sort of round-like shape. So this is the body, and here is the head of Hydra. And I'll click on the brightest star in Hydra, which is called Alphard. We'll talk about that in just a moment. And we'll turn on the constellations. You can see how far Hydra spreads across the sky. And again, many of these stars aren't the brightest, but they do kind of connect together, and I do notice it. And if you want some context of what you're looking at here, you'll find that Leo the Lion is just above it in this location here. You'll also find this star here, Procyon, which is one of the hunting dogs of Orion. That's Orion's tiny dog here. And not too far from that, we have Cancer the Crab, and right here, the Gemini Twins. And so it's near some famous constellations, and hopefully you can find this in this part of the sky. In Greek and Roman mythology, Hydra has a really interesting and famous story and involves Hercules and his 12 labors. If you recall from a few episodes ago, we talked about Hercules having to clear his name of past wrongdoings. And so he was given these very challenging labors or missions to complete, and that was to defeat these scary monsters. And the first of those labors, the first of those challenges, was to defeat the Nemean lion, also known as Leo, which is nearby. His second labor was to defeat Hydra. And Hydra was sent by Hera. She was the queen of the gods and also the wife of Zeus, who is the king of the gods. And Hera despised Hercules because it turns out that Hercules is the love child of Zeus, Hera's husband, and a woman named Alcmene. So Hercules was a forbidden son. Hera did not like him for that reason and made him go crazy in one of the stories. And in Hercules' altered state of mind, he did some really gruesome things. And so eventually he had to clear his name by completing these 12 labors. So he and his nephew Aeolus went to defeat Hydra. And Hydra is also known as the Lernaean Hydra, or the Hydra of Lerna. Lerna was a lake. This was a sea snake that lived in this lake. And not just any sea snake or sea serpent. This was a terrifying beast and monster. The offspring of Typhon and Echidna. Those are titan-like, serpent-like creatures that had many monster offspring that are very famous from Greek and Roman mythology. Hydra is one of them. And Hydra had a special talent. When you cut off one head, terrifyingly, two more would sprout back out and grow. And so it made it a very challenging beast to fight. But Hercules and Aeolus were up to the challenge, and they made their way to the lair of Hydra. They realized that Hydra actually breathed out poisonous fumes, so they had to cover their mouths with cloth to protect themselves. And they quickly learned as they were cutting off heads, as Hercules was using a sword to try to fight Hydra, that all of these heads would start growing back, and it became an even scarier creature to overcome. But eventually, the duo came up with a plan that when Hercules would cut off one head, Aeolus, his nephew, would take a hot torch and burn the severed neck and cauterize the wound to stop the sprouting of two more heads. And so they did that over and over again until one head was left. And as they were doing that, Hera was a little desperate, and she sent another creature to assist Hydra, and that's what is known as Cancer the Crab. Cancer is actually in the sky right above the head of Hydra that we find right there. And this giant crab was also fighting Hercules and Aeolus. But Hercules quickly defeated Cancer the Crab and also took the remaining head of Hydra and put it under a giant rock. And that defeated this terrible sea snake. And of course, Hera was furious. She was very upset that he won again. And so to memorialize the sea snake, Hydra, and Cancer the Crab, she placed them into the stars to remember them forever and create these constellations that we see today, at least as the stories go. Now, as we focus back on Hydra by himself here, one thing you will notice if you are looking in this area of the sky is that there is one star in particular that stands out, and there's not a lot of bright stars nearby. So when you do look in this area, you may notice one star within Hydra that has a bit of a reddish or orangish hue to it. And that's the brightest star in Hydra that you find right there, which is called Alphard. And it's the alpha star of Hydra, which means it's the brightest star of this constellation. And it's very noticeable. Even though it's not one of the brightest stars that you find in the sky, the reddish color to it really stands out. And I always look for that in this area. And it's actually a very luminous star compared to other red stars in the sky. But the thing is, it's pretty far away from us, about 177 light years away. It's a red giant star in its giant phase. And so it's kind of bloated up. It's about 50 times the size of our sun. But because of its distance, it makes Alphard not look as bright as some of the other stars you find nearby. The name is Arabic, and it means the individual because it's sort of by itself in this area of the sky. It's also known as the backbone of the sea serpent or backbone of Hydra as well. So Alphard is a nice little star to find. Again, not one of the brightest, but its reddish color really stands out, and I love looking for that in this area. Now, Hydra and even some of the constellations around it have particular meaning to us at MOAS and in our Lohmann Planetarium lobby because we have a celestial map that represents this area of the sky. And in our Lohmann Planetarium lobby, if you're ever in that area waiting to see a show, we have a wonderful collection of celestial maps that represent a time in history hundreds of years ago when celestial map making was at its height. There was this golden age of celestial maps where the science and artistry combined made for these beautiful atlases. And we have a nice collection that represents some of those over the years. And some of these printed maps date back hundreds of years ago. So it's a wonderful small collection that we have in our Lohmann Planetarium. And featured kind of at the center of that, the largest map, or what we call plate, of a map called the Atlas Coelestis, represents the constellations of Hydra and of a few others. So we have Corvus the Crow near the tail of Hydra. We have Crater the Cup that we find there. We also have a very small dim constellation called Sextans the Sextant, like the celestial tool. And then we have part of Leo that's represented and Virgo the Maiden. So all of these constellations, which represent the spring sky, are really nicely placed in a map that we have here. This is the celestial map that represents that area of the sky in our collection, and you can see featured prominently across most of the image here is Hydra the Sea Serpent in amazing detail, along with Corvus the Crow, Crater the Cup, Sextans the Sextant, a little bit of Leo the Lion, and most of Virgo the Maiden. So it really represents the spring sky very well. And this is just one page, or what's called one plate. You know, notice at the top right here, it says P14. That means plate 14 of something called the Atlas Coelestis, which means starry or heavenly atlas. It's a collection of maps from the observations of John Flamsteed, a very famous astronomer from the 16 and 1700s. He was the first royal astronomer of England, and he founded the Greenwich Observatory, which still stands today. And at the time, at least before his death, he was creating one of the most comprehensive and detailed observations of the sky. And this is just one of those maps from his atlas. This one in particular comes from 1729, and it's just amazing to look at. And it comes from the golden age of celestial maps between 16 and 1800, when the science and the artistry combined made for some beautiful pieces. So it's nice to have this in our collection to represent the spring sky, especially Hydra, the sea serpent. This is a great time of the year in the Northern Hemisphere to find the stars of the Big Dipper, those famous seven bright stars that make this spoon-like shape in the sky. You have three that make up the handle, four that make up the bowl, and they're conveniently placed in the evening sky in the north northeast, so you don't have to wait around too long to see them. And most of you probably know how to find the Big Dipper. There's another little trick that you might also know is at the end of the bowl of the Big Dipper, these two stars will point you almost straight to this star, which you see is lined up with the north. That, of course, is the North Star, also known as Polaris. It is not a very bright star, even though you'd think it would be. It's so famous. it's kind of hard to find. So the Big Dipper is one of the best ways to locate it. I use this trick all the time myself. And even though the Big Dipper is a very famous grouping of stars, it's not a constellation like those 88 established star shapes in the sky. This is something called an asterism, a more regional shape of bright stars that make a much simpler shape in the sky. And not all regions call it the Big Dipper. In England, it's called the plow, like the farmer's tool. Other locations, it's called the wagon pulled by horses. But in North America, or at least in the United States, it is called the Big Dipper. It does kind of look like a spoon in the sky. And the Big Dipper is actually part of a larger grouping of stars, a larger constellation called Ursa Major, which means the Great Bear. The Big Dipper actually serves as the rear end of the bear. The handle is the long tail, and I'll explain why that tail is so long. And if you look below the bowl, and I know it looks like it's above it here, but I think of it as below the bowl, you'll see two groupings of little thin triangles. You have one here, and you have kind of one there. They are noticeable, even though they're not the brightest of stars. These are the legs of the bear. So these are the rear legs, these are the front legs, and the head and nose kind of jut out here of Ursa Major, this great bear in our northern sky. Of course, bears are usually associated with the north, right? So this does come from Greek and Roman mythology. And in one story, one version of the story, Zeus, the leader of all the gods we talk about, he was very lustful and promiscuous, as we all know. And he fell in love with a woman named Callisto. She was a nymph. And eventually Callisto had a son named Arcas. It's not quite clear if Arcas is actually the son of Zeus, but it's kind of suspicious. Well, Hera, the goddess who we talked about before with Hydra, or Juno to the Romans, she found out about Callisto and her son Arcas. And she was quite furious about this. She was very jealous and she hated that Zeus may have had another love child with Callisto. So Hera locates Callisto and for some reason turns her into a bear. Well, Arcas was a hunter and he did not know his mother was turned into a bear, and Arcas was just on a hunt, and Arcas stumbled upon this majestic bear in the forest and killed this bear, not realizing it's his mother. And Zeus found out about this tragic event, and what he did is he turned Arcas into a smaller bear, now considered the stars of the Little Dipper. Little Dipper is actually part of something called Ursa Minor, the lesser bear. And so the story goes is that Jupiter was so distraught by this tragedy that Callisto's son had killed her without knowing it, he took both of these bears by the tail, and Zeus flung them around his head and placed them into the stars. And while he did that, it stretched their tails that you see there. And that's why the tails are so long, according to Greek and Roman mythology. So that's how they're remembered in the sky. And the name Arcas is interesting. It actually comes from the Greek word arctos, which means bear. And that's where the word Arctic comes from. Actually, Arctic means near the bear or northern. So there are ties between that name and the term Arctic, which I think is quite interesting. As you can see, this is an interesting area of the sky to the north with the Big Dipper and the end of the bowl pointing to the North Star there, and the Little Dipper, and of course, Ursa Minor, the lesser bear, and Ursa Major, the greater bear. Hey, that's it for another edition of our Sky Tonight. Thank you so much for tuning in. And if you're in Daytona Beach, please stop by the Loma Planetarium. We'd love to have you there. We're doing shows every day, and you can check out our schedule online if you want to know our show lineup. We have a couple new shows that we're playing now, one called Hubble Universe, where we're talking about the Hubble Space Telescope and the amazing images coming from that observatory these past 31 years. So it's a great new live show we just started this quarter, but we'd love to see you for any show and in the museum as well. So with that, I will say happy International Human Spaceflight Day. I'll also say go Ingenuity, and of course, happy stargazing.